Lawyers of Reddit, what's the stupidest case you've been asked to take on? And did you? My father is a patent attorney, and when I was around 14 he told me about a guy who wanted to patent the iPhone 3 because aliens had given him the design for it. My father told him that if the aliens originally designed, then they were the ones that had to patent it, not him. Freaking genius. I'm a prosecutor, so I don't get hired to represent anyone. I work for the government, but I do have discretion over how the prosecution progresses. That is, deciding to proceed, deciding what to offer in the event of a plea bargain, deciding to withdraw the charges, etc. I had a case a few months ago where a man was charged with shoplifting. Turned out he was 70 years old, had absolutely no criminal record, and had shoplifted a sandwich which he ate politely in the store. He honestly thought he had paid for it. I was so angry that he was ever charged in the first place. When I saw him in court, he was absolutely terrified. I withdrew the charges and wished him well. I have no idea how it progressed that far. I had a client come in saying that he needed to sue Stu for robbing all his checks. When I asked him if Stu had a last name, he said no. When I asked him if he knew any Stu, he said no. When I asked him what proof he had that Stu was robbing him, he showed me all of his pay stubs. There were clear, monthly deductions by Stu. As soon as I saw it, I knew. I asked, "Do you have children?" He said yes. I then told him, "Your Stu is the Stu, the support collection unit. They take money out of your check to pay for your child." He left the office insisting that we needed to find Stu. I did insurance defense for a long time, including insurance fraud investigations for insurance companies. You wouldn't believe how many people take a video inventory of their house only to have it mysteriously burned down the next day. You really can't fix stupid. Woman wanted me to sue McDonald's because their employees beat up her son, who was trying to rob the place. When I was in law school, I did the criminal defense clinic where we help a public defender. I say help because they just give you small cases to do by yourself. I had a guy accused of shoplifting a yellow FUBU shirt. Guess what he wore to the trial? A GD yellow FUBU shirt. I was a civil rights investigator. We had one guy complain that he was fired from his factory job because of his race. He was black. The owner of the factory said it was because the guy was smoking crack on his lunch break. Turns out he was smoking crack on his lunch break, but so were a few of his white co-workers, and they were not fired. The owner agreed to pay the guy 6 months of back pay and give him a neutral reference. I was working in a law firm and got a call from reception advising that someone had arrived needing some intellectual property advice. I arrived at reception to find a clearly disturbed woman with a persistent facial twitch and a small wheeled suitcase. I took her to her conference room to discuss, making sure I kept a good line of sight to reception. She put the suitcase on the table and opened it to reveal a stack of thousands of handwritten pages and one half of a pair of scissors, so I guess a scissor. She explained that she had written a manuscript about how the city council gave her schizophrenia and hepatitis, aliens stole her pets, and that it was all part of a bigger conspiracy involving the army and the Illuminati. She was worried that our local newspaper was going to steal her thoughts and publish her manuscript without her consent, and wanted to register the copyright in her manuscript. We then had a perfectly rational and reasonable discussion about copyright laws. I explained that in our jurisdiction she didn't need to register it and that she had rights as an author automatically on creation of the work. I told her the most useful thing she could do is ensure she had evidence of her creative work, and that she should send a digital copy to herself and a friend, and also leave a copy with a friend. That way, if it was published without her consent, she could prove it was her work. We spoke for nearly an hour. She thanked me and then left. She got free legal advice, and I didn't get stabbed with a scissor. I hope she found the help she needs. A lady in prison in my state tried to sue the State Department of Corrections for holding her against her will. Her lawyer wouldn't touch it. It takes a special kind of stupid to try that. I had a teacher that worked for a major video game publisher, one of the top 10 ones. He told me that when people tried to sue them for small amounts due to some game being bad, they would just pay whatever the person wanted. It was cheaper than dealing with a country's terrible justice system. Except one day a guy sued them because a game was bad. He was a law student, self-representing, and tried to throw the book at the company. They decided to make an exception for this guy. They instead threw the book back at him. The lawsuit kept escalating until both sides wasted lots of time and money. Then as final stroke, they offered to settle in front of a judge. There in front of the judge, they put the price of the game on the table in cash and told the guy to just take it and stop bothering them. The judge thought it was very fair and told the guy that if he refused that settlement he would be fined. Guy was very unhappy. He expended like $5,000 in bureaucracy and airplane fares to get $60. I'm a lawyer, but this happened to a friend of mine. He got engaged and apparently this pissed off his ex-GF. The ex-GF sued him for custody of their two cats and $500,000 for something like the lost value of the cats because she claimed they were service animals. They were not at all service animals. Guy I know worked for the DPP and told me about a case where a guy was up on car theft charges, which is like 5 years max, but he was very likely to get a suspended sentence probation as it was a first ever offense. The dumbass though, thought it would be a good idea to go and intimidate the witness into not testifying. The witness called the cops and had CCTV footage of this, so he copped an extra charge with a 20 year max and there was no way in heck he was getting a suspended sentence or probation on that one. Not a lawyer, yet, but this happened while I was doing my 1L summer internship. I worked at a law library in a county lockup. An inmate was charged with felon in possession and was coming down almost weekly to do research. He was basically looking for a way to get rid of a Walmart receipt and video, which indicated that he had purchased a box of bullets, giving officers cause to search and find the weapon. One day, he brings in one of the law books he purchased and had reviewed. He pointed to the section that discussed reasonable expectation of privacy and argued that the officers had not asked his permission to view the video and thus had invaded his privacy. I pointed to parts of the book that explained reasonable expectations, still wasn't getting it. Finally, I asked him who owned the video. Walmart. Then wouldn't it be their decision? But it's me and the video. Whose video is it? Rinse and repeat for about 5 minutes before he finally huffed off. A lady once called asking us to sue her neighbors. They were using voodoo on her. Fortunately, she had psychic powers and thus knew what they were doing. I respectfully declined. Clients wanted to sue because there were no strawberries in her fruit salad which she bought from a supermarket. Thankfully, a secretary was able to screen the call. She asked if the packet said it had strawberries, and the response was, "No, but I thought it would have." I don't know how these people managed to make it through life. Without going into too many details, had a guy that wanted to bring a class action against the company that made his underwear, because he was convinced his underwear was the reason he had a crooked dong. He assured us that as soon as the jury saw his dong, they'd side with him. No, we didn't take it. I worked as a receptionist at a small personal injury firm and was the first line of defense against the more outlandish cases. One of the most ridiculous calls I took involved a woman wanting to sue her cat's veterinarian for malpractice because her cat scratched her, which in turn supposedly caused her liver to fail and a slew of other health problems to her eyes. She believed the vet was at fault because she was convinced the cat was carrying some obscure disease and the vet had failed to catch it. It was my second day on the job, so I put her through to an attorney, not yet knowing what else to do with such a ridiculous situation. She got a firm sorry, can't help you from our office, in part because we did not do malpractice, veterinary or otherwise, but also because she sounded like a one-way ticket to crazy town. I am a personal injury lawyer in the UK. I took a call from a potential client that had fallen down the stairs in her own home. She had tripped over her own cat. She told me that she wanted to sue her local authority as her home was owned by the council and she was not allowed to keep pets as part of her lease. She claimed that when the house was inspected she was not told to get rid of the cat. It was therefore the council's fault that she fell down the stairs. We didn't take the case on. My mother said that at a law firm she used to work at many years ago they had received a call from a gentleman that wanted to file a lawsuit against Walt Disney. When asked why he was filing suit he claimed that the Disney characters were coming out of the TV and stealing food from his refrigerator. They told him they'd take the case for an advance fee of $100,000 and never heard back from him. A guy found a rock in the middle of Melbourne CBD that he believed came from an underground volcano. Therefore he discovered the volcano and he owned the volcano, and that the Melbourne City Council and indeed the Victorian government should pay him rent to live on top of his underground volcano. No, I did not take on the case. Fun fact, Australia is the only continent with no active volcanoes. I never did much criminal defense, but a man, who we'll call Dennis, came into my office with a driving while intoxicated charge and an aggravated and licensed operation of a motor vehicle charge, both misdemeanors. Dennis swore up, down, and sideways that one, he does not drink and was not intoxicated. 2. He never drove the vehicle. And 3. That he has a valid driver's license. I give Dennis the names of some local criminal defense and DWI attorneys and suggest he try them out. Dennis refuses, saying I'm the lawyer he wants. In hindsight, I should have realized that he probably had already gone to these other attorneys and only came to me after they refused to take his case. I charge the guy $200 for an intake and record review fee and contact the local court, police station, and district attorney's office for information and paperwork. I find out that not only did this guy blow a .18 on the breathalyzer, but the cops did the blood test on him after he kept insisting he wasn't drunk. The blood test came back with a .22 back. As for driving, the separate squad cars witnessed Dennis's vehicle run over a mailbox and drive off. He was followed and pulled over on the block. Per the police report, Dennis was the only person in the car and was in the driver's seat with a seatbelt on. Oh, and I tracked down his license through the DMV and it had expired 3 years ago and was suspended for 2 years prior to that. I called Dennis back into my office and told him he did not have a case that should be taken to trial. Dennis admitted that he probably had been drunk, but he wasn't aware he had been drinking. His son must have put Fireball whiskey in his green tea and he didn't realize there was whiskey in his green tea because he was eating red hot cinnamon candies and had a cold stuffy nose. Anyways, Dennis retains me, but only after I put a clause in his engagement agreement stating I explained his low chance at trial and he understood there was no guarantee of a win. I take the case to trial and, of course, we lose. I was hoping to convince Dennis to take one of the plea offers given to us in advance, but absolutely not. Dennis was sure the judge would understand and he would be found not guilty and everyone would move on. He was sorely disappointed, but only got probation after trial. I think the judge was taking pity on me more than Dennis. Dennis later sued me for his retainer because I didn't adequately defend him. As proof of my inadequate representation, he offered the judge's verdict rendering him guilty. The case was thrown out quickly. I was called by a gentleman, I use the term loosely here, who wanted me to get his son-in-law out of jail from a drug possession charge. Before I could respond, he starts spilling the story. Police were called to the mobile home park for a domestic disturbance between the man and his wife. Call said he was beating the heck out of her in the front yard for the whole neighborhood to see, and they had better hurry. When they arrive on site, the man has calmed down and is sitting in his truck smoking a cigarette, and the woman was bloody, couple of broken bones, if I remember correctly, but was screaming from the front porch and throwing his personal items out the front door, as is regular habit. First thing the police do is ask if there are any firearms around they need to worry about since she has gone back inside. The man says, no, his pistol should be in the box on the back seat. Police ask him if they can open the box to verify it was there. He says sure. When they did, they find no gun, but lots of drugs. He says oh right, gun's under the passenger seat. Police retrieve the gun and take him into custody for the drugs. What makes this the stupidest case is that I got my call from the man's father-in-law who wanted to hire me to go get the guy out of jail and defend him on the charges. I thought a minute about the parties, then asked, if he is your son-in-law, then wouldn't your daughter be the woman who he was beating? He said yay, but he is probably the best she is going to do for herself. One prospective client wanted me to sue Burger King for no longer serving pancakes. And now they are back at 3 for 89 cents. You must have put the fear of God into M. My dad is an in-house lawyer for a major American insurance company. He once spent an entire year trying to help deny insurance benefits for a painter who had stepped off his ladder onto a cat, fallen down the stairs and become paralyzed. The insurance company was arguing that a cat was a commonly expected occupational hazard for a painter and that he was negligent in not checking for cats before stepping down. a whole year of his life, over whether a cat is a known occupational hazard of house painting. Lawyer for 12 years. Client was charged with stealing a mobile toilet. After we won, he told me he still owns it. The sucker has the thing in his backyard because he was lazy as frick. His office was nearby. Forced him to deliver it back at night. Jesus. Still offended that he lied to me the whole time. Worked as IT for a family law firm. One day a lady comes in asking to have an attorney look at her divorce. She goes in with the lawyer and tells him she wants the divorce on the grounds that he was beating her. The attorney explained that he would be willing to do it, but advised that because the marriage was so short, just a few months, the easiest way to get a divorce and get away from her abuser was just to file a no-fault and get it over with. She starts yelling, throwing things at, and hitting him. Mind you, he is an older guy in his late 60s at this point, telling him that if she could get 4 other divorces from him then she could do it a fifth. She had married and divorced the same guy 4 times before this. The firm didn't take the case, but our sister firm did. Turns out she had actually been the abusive one, basically holding him and their kids hostage with threats of telling the police he was abusing the kids and beating her. Guy was arrested for marijuana possession. Arresting officer never actually opened the tin foil bundle involved and checked that it was, in fact, not a burrito. When I was a summer associate, I worked on a case where a lady was suing her apartment complex because she walked out of her unit, slipped on duck poop, and injured herself. We rep the apt complex. The associate I was working for told me to slip as many bird-based puns into the motions pleadings as possible. I happily obliged. Let me preface this. I had heard about the guy I'm going to mention below before I had actually met him. I thought this was an urban legend, until he came into my office one day. A guy in his late 50s early 60s comes into the lobby area of my office and starts a commotion that freaks out the receptionist. I was the closest attorney to the lobby, so I go out and talk to the guy. He was clearly mentally disturbed and presented the following story. Someone had implanted a device in his brain that was controlling his behavior. He believed it was being controlled by Baskin Robbins and a former mayor of Detroit. He believed they were forcing him to do random things like going to bars to drink, taking the wrong turn when driving, forcing him to retire from his job, and a lot of very other intricate things. After asking him if he had seen any doctors regarding the implant, he got really upset and said that he thought the doctors were in on it as well. After telling him I couldn't help him and suggesting that he find some new doctors, he asked me if I knew any lawyers who specialized in his kind of case. I often wonder if the lawyer I referred him to was able to help him. You've been visited by the toothpaste man for good teeth and fresh breath. Comment afresh if you are new to the channel. You can subscribe. I publish new videos every day. Until then, check another video. Or don't. Either way, have a great day, you magnificent people.